Gracious and most eternal God, our Father, we come right now to say thank you, God. We want to thank you for waking us up, God. Thank you for starting us in our right mind, God. We want to thank you for allowing us to come together to learn about your word one more time. God, just thank you for the covering that you have over us. We want to thank you for our families, those that we were born into, God, and those that we've acquired, God. We want to thank you just for being you. God, we ask that you come in right now and open up our hearts and our minds to receive whatever it is that you want us to hear, Lord God. God, we ask that you come in and have your way. We ask that the Holy Spirit takes over and teaches what needs to be taught, God. God, while we're asking for you to come in, God, we want you to come in and touch all of your people, Lord God. God, we come and we bind the spirit of suicide, God. We bind the spirit of self-mutilation, God. We bind the spirit of self-harm, God. We want to be able to be loved and love ourselves as you want us to love ourselves, God. We ask that you open up this Bible study to reveal to us things that we did not know as it relates to self-love, God. We just want you to come in and be you. And God, we ask that you strengthen us, God. Strengthen us in our prayer lives, God. Strengthen us in our study time, God. Strengthen us in our intimate time with you, God. Just strengthen us all together so that we can be better disciples for you, God. Just touch us, Lord, right now in the name of Jesus. Touch right now, God, and touch that your word shall be delivered in a way that we can digest it and we can implement it as quickly as possible, God. And God, right now, we lift up your servant, Nina, to you, God. We ask that you give her the words that you want to say, God, and that you just open her up so that whatever it is that needs to come out, God, that it is delivered and done in your name, God. Strengthen her, God. Protect her house. Protect her child, Lord. Protect her family, God. Give her all the desires of her heart, Lord God, for doing what it is that you have asked her to do, God. God, we ask again that you come in, Lord God. Help us, free us, and deliver us in all things. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Thank God. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Welcome, everyone, to this Saturday's Bold Bible Study teaching. This is our second Bold Bible Study of 2022. And my name is Nina Anderson. If this is your first time here, I am the founder of Faith to Bold and your Bold Bible Study teacher. What a privilege it is to serve you. Before I get started, I just want to say thank you to Sister Nikisha for opening us up in prayer and for co-facilitating for us today. God bless you and thank you for your service. Before I get deep into the weeds in terms of our word, I just want to share a little bit about myself because I think it's important you know who you are spending your time with. Again, my name is Nina Anderson. I was born in Jackson, Mississippi. I spent formative years in California, and now I reside in Texas. I was born into a Holy Ghost-filled, tongue-speaking Pentecostal church right in the Bible Belt. If you're from Jackson, you would be familiar with the church. I went to Bethlehem Temple, Greater Bethlehem Temple, and I was baptized under Bishop Philip Coleman. My leaders now are Apostles Daniel and Natricia McClendon of Revolution Church in Lancaster, California. A warm shout out to my Revolution Church family. I love you and thank you for joining me today. And I know we're spread all across time zones. So if you are spending your time with me, it is a privilege, it is an honor, and I love you. What are our beliefs, my beliefs in particular? I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe in everything about him. I believe that he died for my sins, that he rose again, and not just my sins, but our sins, the sins of mankind, that he rose again, that he continues to make intercession for us at the right hand of the Father. Even today, I believe in the power of his name, and I believe in the power of his blood. I believe that he left his Holy Spirit to be of comfort and counsel to us. And I believe Jesus is the only way to God, our Father. So that's a little bit about me, just wanting to set the tone in terms of belief system. Mission and vision for Faith to Bold is to really influence and galvanize people to live boldly in their walk with Christ and to walk in holy boldness. If you're not familiar with the term galvanize, that means to cause people to become excited or vested about an issue or an idea. We know that our faith is not just an idea, it is a lifestyle, it is what we live. And I want to encourage my brothers and sisters in the body of Christ to become more bold in their walk with God. And we glean boldness from the word of God. We are not bold without it. We are not bold without him. So hopefully in today's teaching and any other teaching, I get to share some biblical truth with you that will build you up on your journey. If you haven't already, go ahead and grab your Bibles, journals, and pens. We're going to go ahead and dive in today's topic. So this week is love week, if you will, more so love month. I know that February is a time where everyone is talking about love interest and they're showering each other with love. And you see all the happy Valentine's Day messages and texts all over the place, all over social media. I'm surrounded and connected to singles, including myself, who are waiting in their waiting period, waiting for the Lord to release their spouse to them or cause their spouse to identify with them. I don't think that there is anything wrong with desiring a mate. And for the singles this year, however, the message on social media was really focused around self-love. And it left a bad taste in my mouth. It was kind of bitter. I don't know if self-love, like the antidote, was just on steroids this year, but the agenda was really heavy to me. At the start of the pandemic, actually, I started to take on a different perspective of self-love and what self-love really looked like and what it is. Nikisha and I host a podcast together called The Jewel Drop. And so in our last season, our more recent season of the show, I teed up this idea for an episode where we talk about the toxicity of self-love. So I've been sitting on this word for a minute, and now I get to unlock it with all of you. So again, I'm privileged to be able to share this with you. If you saw any of my posts leading into this Bible study, you know that I struggled with really bringing this forward. I felt isolated even in talking about the topic. It's a touchy topic. It's a sensitive topic. And what I share is really an unpopular opinion. So human to human, you know, it doesn't matter how saved we are or how deep we are, how anointed we are, human to human, I didn't want to, so to speak, rain on anyone's parade about loving themselves. But when there is an agenda, a worldly agenda or a cultural agenda that seeks to deceive or even destroy people, it is the responsibility of those within the kingdom of God to weigh that agenda against the word of God. So I am approaching this objectively with the word of God and how he defines self-love, even, because he does believe in you loving yourself. But of course, there is a way of taking it too far and twisting what his original intent of love is. So today's topic is demystifying the falsehood of self-love. That's the title the Lord gave me. And so that's what we're rocking with. And we'll start with just two basic definitions before we get into the meat of the teaching. So demystify. I know that that word can be intimidating if you've not heard it before, but demystify is really just to debunk or to provide clarity to something, to expound on it, to unriddle an idea or a topic. A falsehood is a lie or an untrue statement. It is the absence of truth or the practice of lying. So in essence, what we are doing is debunking the lies the culture of self-love tells us or has told us. If I am going too fast, feel free to let me know in the comments. And if not, then I'm going to just keep on pressing through because I want to be cognizant of everyone's time. So as I was preparing for this Bible study, I was drawn to this verse in the Bible in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. And it reads, "But know this, that in the last days, perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. And from such people turn away." That was a mouthful, but I pray that the Lord adds a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his word. I'm going to say a quick prayer and then we'll keep moving forward. So dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time today. We thank you for this ordained moment to come before you, Lord, to be intimate with you, to know you, to receive more knowledge about your nature and your intent of self-love or love in general, loving others, Lord. Father, I ask that you cause scales to fall from the eyes of those who are deceived by inaccurate doctrine, Lord, that would seek to deceive their hearts, to pull them away from you, pull them away from your word in the name of Jesus. Lord, I am merely a vessel. I decrease that you may increase and have your way. May this word be planted up on hearts that are ready to receive, oh Lord. And whether I am planting a new seed or watering an existing seed, I ask that you give the increase for your glory. In the name of your son, Jesus Christ, I pray, amen. All right, let's keep going. Now, that same verse, if you look at other translations, the very end of verse 5, it says, "And from such people turn away from," or "and from such people turn away." Some translations say, "and turn such people away," i.e. avoid those types of people. And you better believe that in the body of Christ right now, today, there are prominent men and women with big platforms who are preaching and teaching self-love. And instead of providing balance or even correction to the rhetoric, they are flocking. People are flocking towards them and sowing and tithing into these types of words and signing up for the next conference because they've been coerced into believing that they just need to love themselves more. And so that's something for us to think about, especially when the text, the Holy Bible says that we are to be aware of those people and to avoid those types of people. Does that mean that we reject them? No, but you can reject the word if it is not in alignment with the word of God. So during today's teaching, I want to make sure that we're not using self-love and self-care interchangeably. I say this because out of obligation, you can care for something you don't know how to love. And on the flip side of that, you can love something or someone that you don't know how to take care of or nurture or develop a relationship with. I'll give you an example. So if someone goes out of town, let's say a friend goes out of town, right? And they need you to stop by and check on their plants and the kitties and make sure everyone is continuing to grow and is well nourished while they are out of town. I can go do that out of obligation to my friend, but it doesn't mean I love their plants or their pets even. And then flip side of that, loving something or someone and not knowing how to take care of that. I have family members I love, but I'm not going to necessarily take care of them, or maybe I'm the only one, but there are family members I love that I don't nurture relationships with for multiple reasons. So we see that even in romantic relationships and sometimes friendships, where people don't know how to maintain or nurture healthy relationships with the right people. That's a whole other can of worms. I'll save that for another Bible study, but I just wanted to make sure that we have some ground rules as we discuss and talk about and dive into self-love a little more. All right, so what is self-love? When I was researching, I couldn't come up with a terminology for myself, like in terms of a definition, but what I found that was common across a lot of platforms and blogs was self-love is the belief that you hold that you are a valuable and worthy person. I have a typo there, but a worthy person. That's a broad definition of self-love. If you are out there, tell me what you think self-love is. But the definition that I found was very broad, and it left room for interpretation. Too much room for interpretation of something can also leave room for error. That definition alone sounds good. It sounds harmless. It sounds safe even, but isn't that in alignment with the sneakiness and the slyness that we see from the enemy? It looks good. It looks enticing. It looks intriguing. It's not too heavy of a lift. And so it's supposed to make you feel good. But the issue is that if you struggle with understanding your value and your worth, then you struggle with identity. So self-love is an identity issue, and you don't find that in particular across many platforms, because self-love is all about what makes you feel good in most cases. So the world itself is self-seeking, self-fulfilling. It is full of these types of ideologies. And this generation, the more recent generations, are hell-bent on being seen. They want to be heard. They want to be validated. They want you to know, you know, how they think you should be reacting and responding to them in heated moments. And it doesn't even have to be heated, but we've really seen where this generation is rising up, and sometimes they even become unruly because they are seeking to be validated. There's an instant gratification in something that's temporary, like self-love. You don't have to look outside of yourself for self-love. You don't have to go into uncharted, uncomfortable territories if the only thing you need to rely on is your own ability to love yourself. However, when something happens that will challenge how you've identified with yourself in terms of loving yourself and self-love, then those feelings of inadequacy, the insecurity, the feelings of unworthiness, the devaluing of yourself, the anxiety, the depression, the fear, the apathy, the self-loathing, that all comes back up to the top, because loving yourself isn't enough. And loving yourself too much does the opposite of making you whole. because you are further devoiding yourself of what real love is. You cannot make yourself whole. None of us can. None of us possess the power to make ourselves whole. So I do want to touch just briefly on toxic positivity, because we are all about positivity. I opened up saying everybody wants to feel good. Everyone wants good vibes, you know, positive energy. I'm loving the vibe. I put self-love in the same category as Black girl magic, diva, goddess. You're a strong Black woman. You know, you need to do some shadow work. You know, do you boo, do what makes you feel good. Everyone wants these positive feelings. But this new age language of vibes and I'm spiritual is leading people right down a path of deception, because none of those things are gospel. Self-love is not gospel. Self-love is not good news. When Christ returns, it won't matter how much you loved yourself. It will matter, though, how much you allowed him to love you and how you allowed him to leverage you as a vessel to display his love to other people, including yourself. The craftiness of self-love is that you push Christ out and then you begin to idolize your own ability to make yourself somehow better and rise above what you've experienced in life. And I am the bad news bear right now for people who are heavy on the self-love, because you are not capable of loving yourself more than God loves you. It's just not possible. Let me know if this is helping you, but it is not possible for you to love yourself more than God loves you. So a familiar passage about God's love that we all know is John 3:16, which says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believed in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." So here's a question. When you look back on your life and you look back on your sin, you look back on your faults, you look back on your failures, you look back on your ugliness, would you allow your child who has never sinned, who has been completely pure, who is completely untainted, unmarked, and unblemished, would you allow your pure, innocent child to die for a full mankind of you? Would you allow your child to die for a full mankind of you? Tell me, let me know in the chat, would you allow your child to die for a full mankind of you? Okay, nope, I wouldn't either. I wouldn't either. I wouldn't let my child die for 10 million of me. I wouldn't even let her die for one of me, because I know what I've done. And if we were capable of only needing to love ourselves, then we wouldn't need a savior. So I pose this, that self-love is toxic in part because it teaches us and trains our brains to believe that we don't need a savior. And we all need Jesus. People need Jesus more than they need us, because we're merely vessels. We, however, want to believe that we are fine and we are okay just how we are, and we don't need to change. We want our authentic selves to be enough when we show up in a space or an environment. But if you struggle with identity, which is what I just said a couple of slides ago, if you struggle with identity, you don't even know who you are so that you can show up and be your authentic self, because you're not in alignment with your own identity. You have no understanding of it. And this is the opposite of what Christ not only teaches us, but that he commands us with. For instance, in Luke 9, 23 through 24, he said to all, "If anyone who comes after me Let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. Irony, you got to lose yourself in Christ in order to really understand your identity. So it doesn't happen in you or with just you. It happens when you lose yourself in him. Another scripture is Galatians 2:20 that says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I did not give myself up for me. Christ gave himself for me. He gave himself for you. He gave himself for us. And there's no saving or amount of love we can give ourselves that would supersede what he has done for us. Another scripture is 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 through 9. It says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I just said, as we were getting into the topic, that part of the self-love agenda is to say, there is nothing wrong with me. I don't need help. I don't need to be better. But this verse, 1 John 1, 8 through 9, is saying we've all fallen short. We've all sinned. And the only way we are justified is by the blood of Jesus, is by Jesus dying for us. And we should not minimize that in our walks. We should not let others or allow others to devalue the fact that we need Christ in order to do anything. We're going to dive into that a little more. But self-love teaches you not to die to yourself. And as a believer, we know that we die to ourselves daily. We deny ourselves daily or mostly daily. And we still fall short, even after we deny ourselves daily. It's a lifestyle. It's not just a one and done. It doesn't happen just one time. But until we leave this earth, we're going to be denying ourselves over and over again. We're going to deny ourselves the ability, like, to clap back at people. We're going to deny ourselves, you know, that next scoop of ice cream. You know, if you're struggling with food addiction, we're going to deny ourselves temptation, even in lust and fornication. We deny ourselves. And that's ongoing. But denying ourselves, as we read the text, means that there is more fulfillment that we can obtain and receive from Christ our Lord. And so self-love is about, consider yourself first and foremost. Jesus said, you need to die to yourself. Those are juxtaposing ideas. And one's not even real. It's an idea. It's an ideology. But people are preaching it as gospel. And that cannot be the case for us. We do not conform to the ways of this world, but we are transformed by the renewing of our mind in Christ. And we learn more about him in his word. And if we weren't going to struggle with putting ourselves on some type of pedestal to be able to get over things, Christ would not have clearly stated, you're going to have to put yourself down in order to follow me. You will have to put yourself down, not debase yourself. That is not what we're talking about. You're going to have to die to yourself and what self thinks self should look like and identify as to follow me. Does that make sense, everyone? Am I going too fast? Let me know. All right. So people get high from self-love because it is fleeting. There are these fleeting moments of self-gratification, where you are happy and beaming, and for however long it takes, you know, you are that way. And there is a danger in that because it becomes addictive. And so every time you choose self-love in a capacity of not doing something that the Lord has told you to do, when you choose to do you or feel good and feel all the good vibes, you do get a high from it, and you introduce the self-gratification into your life. And then you get to the point where you are not willing to be uncomfortable or be vulnerable in your weaknesses. And we're not superhumans. That's not how we were designed. Be strong. Be strong in the Lord. You know, boast in him. Boast in him. Not in all the stuff that you did to make yourself feel good and pull yourself out the pit, you know. And there are instances where people in the Word of God, in the Scripture, encourage themselves. David was a sinner and a man after God's own heart, and encouraged himself in the Lord. Don't limit what living for God looks like, because you can't have what you want at the like ding of a microwave, because that's exactly what it is, microwave mentality. And you don't want to become subjected or a slave to it. So once you start dealing with self-gratification, and you're doing all these things to make yourself feel good, and you're, you know, able to provide yourself with some sense of glorification that you made it, and, you know, you didn't sit in it for too long, then you have to deal with an inflated ego. And I heard this terminology for ego once before, as easing God out. Ego, easing God out. And ego is really a person's sense of self-esteem or self-importance. But once you start putting yourself on a pedestal that you probably shouldn't be on, then you start operating outside of what God is instructing you to do or has commanded you to do, because you feel like you're more important than that. Sometimes God will cause you to do stuff that, you know, it doesn't make you feel important. Serving all the time doesn't necessarily make you feel important. You know, being subservient to people doesn't always make you feel important. Running through a master to-do list for a boss who makes, you know, $500,000 more than you, whatever the case may be, that doesn't necessarily make you feel important. But it's okay for you to not feel important all of the time. It happens. That's a part of life. And once you start dealing with inflated ego, you also start dealing with pride. Now, here's one definition of pride: a feeling of deep pleasure or satisfaction derived from one's own achievements, the achievements of those with whom one is closely associated, or from qualities or possessions that are widely admired. And that is pride in and of itself, devoid of anything the Lord has done to bless you get to where you are, or to bless you to get those accomplishments. There's no acknowledgement of him in pride. And if you're dealing with pride, at some point you're going to start dealing with false humility. And self-love builds false humility in this way. When you are operating under the spirit of false humility, you put on a front like what Jesus did for you is not enough. It's not enough. When someone says, "Oh, sister, you really prayed today," and you say, "Oh, well, you know, I probably could have did better." If you continue to condemn yourself for sins that God has already forgiven you for, or even condemn yourself based on some false expectation you think You didn't think you got in the clouds that time during prayer. You stuttered, you stumbled over a few words. You delivered a word and you started stuttering. You got, you know, distracted for a moment. If you condemn yourselves for those things, you are in essence telling God that Jesus's death on the cross was not enough for the forgiveness of your shortcomings. I know we don't always see it like that, but that's what false humility is. If he says that you're an intercessor for the kingdom of God, then baby, you're an intercessor. If he says you are a prophet, then you're a prophet, regardless as to what it is you think your shortcomings are. If he says you are a teacher, then you're a teacher. If he says you are fearfully and wonderfully made, guess what? You are fearfully and wonderfully made. If he says you are set apart, you are set apart. So at some point, we have to stop condemning ourselves for being human and accept that what Christ did at Calvary covers all of that. And he doesn't condemn us. What he does and what he has done is enough. So overindulging in self-love introduces more confusion, really, into an already jacked up type of situation where you are struggling with your identity. Submitting to Jesus means we are developing into who we are called to be. Submitting to Jesus makes us bold enough to say, I don't have it all together, but I can't do it by myself either. More importantly, it puts you, your heart in the posture of, Lord, if you don't help me do it, if you don't do it, it won't get done. There's no other way for this to happen. Overindulgence in self-love steals glory from God. And so we want to be cautious that that is not what we are doing on our journey. And we've talked about identity a lot. Self-love does trigger an identity crisis. I think when people are, and not even an I think, but when people begin to overindulge in self-love, and that's the only thing that they can focus on. I need to do stuff to show that I love myself more. I should be doing blah, blah, blah for me and all this other stuff. The strive for self-love is really an identity crisis because they've not experienced the love of God and they have not accepted who they are in him. So it causes the following. And this is a slide from the last Bible study. I find it interesting, although I know it is not necessarily a surprise. Sorry, I had to let someone in. And although it's not necessarily a surprise, but every topic the Lord has given me in 2022 to conduct a Bible study teaching on has been around identity. There is a massive identity crisis that is going on in the church right now, and we cannot get swooped up into the ways of this world in terms of who we are. It is imperative that we understand who we are in Christ, not outside of Christ. So an identity crisis does three things. Number one, it perverts your perception of God and his love for you. Number two, you cannot perceive truth about him or truth about yourself. And number three, lack of knowledge of his promises to you and his promises and the validation of his promise. That is what an identity crisis does. Now, it's interesting because most of us would say that we don't want to appear weak in front of people. We don't want to be vulnerable in front of others. But the truth is, we are weak without Christ. The truth is that without Christ, we are not enough. And there is nothing wrong with that. There is nothing wrong in owning it. It is nothing wrong with acknowledging it. You're not beating yourself up or beating yourself down when you say it, but you know that you cannot, you know, accomplish certain things without him, nothing. Without him, you know, many of us wouldn't even be here. We wouldn't even be here today partaking in fellowship together if we had to lean on ourselves. Every month, I'm going to share something briefly with you all. Every month, the week of Bold Bible Study, literally all hell breaks loose in my entire life across every area of life. Something happens, you know, with my kid, something happens at work, the house is in complete disarray, people are getting sick, and it's insane. So if I had to just rely on loving myself, and if I didn't know God, every month Bold Bible Study would be canceled. It probably wouldn't even happen at all, because I'm not enough to continue forth with the mandate. I made a choice. And so me being here is a reflection of my yes to do, what it is he called me to do, and what I committed to him in doing. My surrender. But if I had to solely rely on Nina, you guys would never see me except, you know, however we talk to each other, you know, FaceTime, on the phone, via text, social media, and that would be it. So the thought of this world is that you have to have it all together and there should be no fault in you, but I challenge that. God shows up and does his best work when we have complete uncomfortable reliance on him. In scripture and in life, we are reminded of how weak we are. And yet it's the very thing we fight to hold on to. We fight to hold on to ourselves. We don't want to lose ourselves. You should not lose yourself in another person, but it's okay to lose yourself in God. Scripture, again, and God has proven it time and time again that his spirit is capable, his spirit is strong, his spirit is able to achieve mind-blowing things. His spirit endows and allows miracle signs and wonders to happen. His spirit is all-knowing and all-powerful, but we gravitate to certain practices that would encourage us to reject the fact that he is all-knowing, all-powerful, capable of all things, and able to be all things to all men everywhere. So why would we embrace or fight to embrace something that is so temporal? And that's comfort of our flesh, comfort of our feelings. And feelings are fickle. And we're not saying you're not gonna have feelings. We all have them, but you also have to check those feelings and put them in their proper place. Those feelings are not better, higher, or have more merit than God. There's no more merit that your self-love will have over the merit of Christ's love for you. And if someone can help me understand why we would reject the Lord or flesh, help me understand it. Why are we gravitating so far from it? It's something that I have pondered myself. And again, it just goes right back, at least for me, to not knowing ourselves, not knowing Christ, and having not surrendered and submitted things to him that we should, and fighting to hold on to it. As believers in Christ, we are followers of Christ. And if we are to follow him, that means we are also to reflect him. And something that society pushes, or let's say this hidden agenda of self-love or culture, it pushes self-reliance, it pushes self-discovery. And in part, that is true. You should know who you are, but not outside of Christ, not apart from him. If we are called to imitate Christ, then why would we need to create this special image of who we are, of who we are ourselves? Of course, we're all different. We're not all going to look the same, talk the same, pray the same, read the same, study the same. We are different in our own ways of reflecting him, but we are still only one body with many parts. But the identity of that body is rooted in Christ. So submitting to Jesus actually resolves the identity crisis. Submitting to Jesus causes you to have to lose yourself to find yourself. It causes you to embrace the love of a father and a savior who still intercedes for you at the right hand of God today. And in doing so, you allow the Holy Spirit to dwell within you. So you reach outside of just you and allow the Holy Spirit to come in you. And the Holy Spirit is a counselor who ushers you into the knowledge of knowing who you are and understanding your identity, not just your identity, but understanding the multifaceted nature of God and what he wants for you, what he desires for you to have. All of that is ushered in by the Holy Spirit. Now, some of this doesn't sound very encouraging for people who are really heavy on the self-love, but let me tell you something. It is liberating. It is a liberating experience to walk with Christ. The most liberating experience you will ever have. And to know that we are worthy and we are valued in him. We have been bought and paid for, justified and redeemed by the blood of Jesus. And when you accept Jesus, his love allows you to be a vessel of his love. His grace allows you to be a vessel of his grace. You don't have to perform for it. You don't have to grind for it. You don't have to make a name for yourself. You don't need to measure up to the standards of society. You don't even have to measure up to the false expectations and standards that you put on yourself, because you are loved by Abba, your good father, who is perfect and holy, and he fashioned you in his likeness. And his expectation, or the commandment that he gives, is in Luke 10 and 27. He only needs you to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. Now, I want to ensure that we rightly divide this verse, because this scripture has been abused and misused for generations. I remember this scripture coming up when I was a kid about loving yourself as you, or loving your neighbor as you love yourself. Jesus was not saying in this scripture, when you read it in context, he was not saying that in order to love your neighbor, you must first love yourself. If that was what he meant, that is what he would have said. But he never said that. He never said that there was a requirement of loving yourself adequately in order to love someone else, or love your brother, your sister. The statement in Luke clearly assumes that we already love ourselves. We're born doing that. And the first example we see of loving ourselves and looking for self-gratification is actually in Genesis in chapter 3, when Eve is in the garden with the serpent and she allows herself to be deceived and instead indulges in what she wants to do and achieve her own knowledge. So loving ourselves has been ongoing since Genesis, since the garden, which is why Jesus calls us to love others as we love ourselves, because he knows we already love ourselves. It's kind of like, you don't need to do any additional loving of yourself. I get it. Y'all love yourselves. Okay. We already live lives completely for ourselves. We seek education, we seek careers, we seek titles, we seek money, we seek relationships for ourselves. So Jesus is telling us to love others in that same way, as if when you make a choice as it relates to a neighbor or to someone close to us, it is actually meant to serve them, to serve someone besides just yourself. The calling here is to demonstrate his love for others by doing our best to love like him. So this command is really about following him and serving others, and it has nothing to do with you. And as people come into the understanding of that, it will shift their perspective. I mean, they're going to say ouch or amen, but largely most of what we encounter in this life is not about us. It's about the Lord. It's about advancing his kingdom. So at the top of the teaching, we looked at the broad definition of self-love, which was the belief that you hold that you are a valuable and worthy person. I also noted that if you struggle with understanding your value and your worth, then you struggle with identity. So we're going to go over just briefly what self-love is, especially when you overindulge in it. Number one, identity is self-love is an identity issue. And going back to what we talked about earlier, an identity crisis or an issue of identity, number one, perverts your perception of God and his love for you. Number two, causes you to not be able to perceive truth about him or truth about yourself. I don't know if I said number two or number three, but number three, lack of knowledge of his promises to you and validation of those promises to you. And I will do another recap as soon as I get through all of the slide in case you all are taking notes. Self-love is also a heart issue. Now, we haven't unpacked this one yet, but I'm going to briefly cover it. The Lord tells us in Deuteronomy chapter 5, verses 7 through 8, if I'm not mistaken, that we should have no other idol before him. So the real question is, who rules your heart when your sole focus in and around love is self-love? Are you at the center of it? Is the world's idea of love or self-love at the center of it? Is Christ at the center of it? Who's at the center of your heart and your understanding of love? Is the focus on you trying to be more like Christ, or are you trying to be who you want to be absent of him? That's a real question. Because much of what we encounter in these last days are heart issues. The posture of our hearts are not correct, and we have to repent for those behaviors. I know people like to say, you know, at the end of the day, I'm so tired of that term. At the end of the day, it is what it is. I say, when Jesus comes, are you going to be okay telling him as you are giving him an account of what you did? Are you going to be okay telling him, I spent most of my time here learning how to love myself a little better? Because again, the time that we spend here is not about us. When you're called home to glory, it's not going to be about you. It's not going to matter how much you loved yourself. When you're in the presence of God, you're going to experience like unending, unlimited, grand love, joy, peace, and happiness, not even in the body you had to struggle with here on earth, but being made perfectly whole. So are you okay with giving him that account of how you spent your time? Number four, self-love is a smokescreen into darkness that keeps you bound to the wrong things. Here's what I mean by that. Self-love sounds good. It sounds good to validate yourself, to talk yourself up, to love yourself, to make yourself feel good, to make yourself feel whole and accepted. But when something challenges that make-believe system of yourself that you have created in your mind or allowed the enemy to have, you know, a play date in a sandbox with, your struggle with self-image, rejection, abandonment, intimidation, fear of never having love, fear of not knowing love, fear of leaving this earth having never experienced love, depression, anxiety, suicide, apathy, self-loathing, debasing yourself, hurting yourself. All of that is going to creep back into the forefront because you built this ideology on something that was temporal. Christ is the cornerstone, the chief cornerstone of our faith. any house built outside of him will fall. One day it will fall. And that is not like a doomsday message. That's just straight up fact. If you build on something faulty, if you build a house on sand, it's gonna come down at some point. So self-love does open a portal or is a smokescreen to darkness and deception when you are not clear on what God's intention of love is, or even how you treat yourself. Self-love advocates for you to do you and not do God, not do God's word, not do the work, not submit to his will. You just out here doing you, and you want everybody else to do them too, because you all about peaceful vibes. Everything is not going to be puppies and rainbows in this life. I don't know how long it's going to take for us to get it. But as believers, we don't do us. We do God. Period. And it should be no other way. And in closing, self-love is not a superpower. You're not superhuman. Self-love is not a superpower. You cannot heal yourself or save yourself. You will never be able to love yourself the way that God loves you, because again, you would not give your unblemished, untainted, pure child up to a many people who are full of corruption, self-loathers, self-seekers, self-lovers, thieves, murderers, and treacherous, and all the other things that were called out in the 2 Timothy verse. You wouldn't give your child up for a full mankind of those things. So when it's all said and done, you will never be able to love you the way God loves you. I'm going to share with you what I prayed over myself as I was working through doing my own work to not be deceived into self-love, because again, it's something that came up for me during the pandemic. And then something that just is a word that grew much stronger over time. So what I did, and I have the steps here, and we're going to talk about those in a second, but personally, and you can implement this for yourself, what I started to pray was, Lord, give me eyes to see me the way you see me, because I didn't see myself the way he saw me. I didn't see myself as called. I didn't see myself as anointed. I didn't see myself as worthy. I didn't see myself as valuable. As a matter of fact, I thought I was largely a burden to most of the people in my life. I also felt like it would be better if I wasn't here. And if you've ever heard my testimony, you also know that I struggled with suicide, and I actually attempted to take my own life. By the grace of God, that was unsuccessful, but I know a thing or two about building a belief on faulty word. And when things start coming down or crashing around you, it will shake the very core and foundation of who you are if you have attempted to do that without Christ. Now, earlier, I mentioned quite a few scriptures, and you start overcoming the heresy of self-love by spending more time with God. And how are you spending your time with him? You pray. You definitely repent for thinking that you could love yourself better than he could love you. You study his word, so that you get an understanding of who you are to him, so that he can reveal his nature to you. If you follow Revolution Church, you know that our apostle Daniel McClendon has been teaching heavily on prayer and the names of God and how the keys of the kingdom help unlock mysteries unknown to us. You only start to get mysteries in the presence of God. He's not going to turn the key over to a locksmith who's going to lose the key. But we have keys. We have the word of God. And so it's just a key that we're not putting to use. So I encourage you in spending time with God, make sure that you are also spending time in his word. Fasting makes the flesh uncomfortable. Let me tell you, we just did our fast, our corporate fast. And I think a few of us were quite uncomfortable for a few days during that fast. And it was a Daniel fast, but we couldn't have, somebody remind me, we couldn't have what, wheat? We couldn't have grains, no grains. Daniel fast with no grains. Baby, some of the folks were reeling. I know they were, even if they didn't say anything about it. But we could not have grains. So it was another level up. It was more of a standard and requirement that was raised, but many of us needed that. So that coming out of the last season, we were better equipped and stronger for the season we are currently in. And another way to spend time with God is simply to worship him, praise him, thank him. You know, we can say, God, fix it, fix it, fix it. But in some instances, we need to worship him and thank him for not fixing it. For not fixing what we thought was going to make us better, feel better, or be whole, or feel adequate. Thank him for that. Now, I'm convinced more than ever that people are afraid to read the word of God because they prefer comfort over conviction. There are things that you read in the Bible that will convict you. There are things the Lord will cause you to know that will convict you. So it's not even limited to them reading the Bible. They just don't want to be in his presence because in his presence, only truth can exist. Only real can exist. And in his presence, some of the things you may be concerned about, he already has an answer to. But because we are a society that is used to trauma bonding, and we bond and talk about the woe is me, people have attached themselves to the woe is me narrative instead of attaching themselves to the new testimony that God wants to give them. You don't lose yourself by allowing God to change the narrative. He is just writing another chapter to the story, and he is the author and finisher of our faith. It can't have a better ending with a better author than him. So don't be afraid to get in the presence of God, to spend time with him, that he may help you in your unbelief, help you in your fear, help you in your lack of knowledge, and help you not be deceived by some of the practices that are pushed by today's world and culture. That actually concludes today's teaching. I'm going to pray and then we'll see if there are any questions. Nikisha, if you'd like, you can go ahead and stop recording.